Brandy Melville. If you know, you know. And I don't know if you've ever seen like the TikToks that people make making fun of, or I guess just showing like how Brandy employees treat people of color, people who maybe don't fit in the archetypal Brandy girl aesthetic.
Holla at me. I'm never too ill to say what up. Like, it's not that serious.
If you weigh more than like 7 pounds and 2 ounces, I swear Brandy Melville employees will look at you like you just fed over their dog or something. Say no car.
Now, don't get me wrong, guys. Am I a victim to the Brandy pandemic? Yes, I am. I am wearing a Brandy Melville jacket right now as I'm filming, and I have a Brandy tank inside, and I have a couple of other Brandy items as well, and I went to the Brandy store in Manhattan over break. Yes, I did, and it's because it's just something about the way the clothes fit is so nice, which is actually very interesting because they know their audience to a T, and I'll dive into that in a little bit. Today, I thought I would get cozy on my bed and, I thought I'd get cozy in my bed and just talk to you guys about my perspective on Brandy Melville as a business, why they're so successful, even though they follow very different unconventional paths when comparing them to their main competitors and also major retailers that are doing as well or similarly as well as them. I'm a fashion and business student, and so this is sort of my area. I love analyzing brands and their marketing strategies. I love analyzing brands and their strategies in general, who they cater to and how they deliver value to those customers. Hopefully it's not too business jargony, but if you guys are interested in like marketing or business secrets behind the most successful brands and why they're successful, don't forget to like and comment what other things you want me to analyze. I've done Barbie on this channel, I've done K-pop, and I think I want to do one on Taylor Swift, Queen T Swift, very soon, so stay tuned for that. Also, I am Jasmine. Welcome to my channel if you don't know who I am. I am a junior at Cornell. I study business and fashion, as I said, and I also make vlogs and stuff like that, so definitely follow along if you want to see my journey at Cornell. Okay, so first, starting off with what the heck is Brandy Melville? So because I'm a business student, I want to break it down into the 3 C's framework. 3 C's stands for customer, competition, and company. Not necessarily in that order, but it basically breaks it down into a very clear framework and structure in thinking about a brand and what it has to offer. So the first C is company, and I want to look at the history of Brandy Melville as well as company strengths, weaknesses, capabilities, things like that. So first of all, in very simple terms, Brandy Melville is an Italian clothing brand founded in the early 80s by Silvio Marzan and his son, who are from Italy. And it is a fashion and accessories brand that sells primarily to younger audiences, such as teen girls, as well as young women. And they have brick and mortar stores around the world, in Europe and the US, but they also sell online through e-commerce. So actually, this is super interesting because This is super interesting because I didn't know this about Brandy until researching it, but basically the story behind the name Brandy Melville is that Brandy is an American girl and she's on vacation in Rome and she meets an Englishman called Melville, and they basically meet and fall in love, and so it's sort of a love story that started the brand name. And I think it sort of points to Brandy's aesthetic as like aspirationally European, French girl kind of, but rooted in California. So like it has that beachy Californian aesthetic, but has European roots. So it's sort of like that marriage between both worlds. Now, if I had to pinpoint one key competitive advantage or like differentiator, if you guys don't know, differentiator just means what makes this brand stand out, what makes the brand different from other brands that are similar. Brandy Melville has a very distinct aesthetic. It sort of combines, again, that like Malibu laid-back casual vibe with the more classic and chic European style. Every single Brandy Melville store that I've ever walked into is the same cozy vibe of like, they have like paneled wooden walls. They have like fairy lights, super cozy and very appealing towards me. Those are some of its strengths, but some weaknesses are definitely its controversies around the one size business model that they operate under. So they only sell one size of clothing, which is definitely very strange, weird, kind of odd for a company to be doing in 2023. Also, what's weird is that the clothing is not even like for petite frames because the sleeves are really long and the pants are also very long. So, I mean, as a 6 foot girl, that's fine for me, but I know a lot of people who don't have long limbs like that and are petite. So like, who are they trying to fit really? Like a tall girl who's skinny basically. And although I do fit that, and that's why I buy the clothes, is because I can fit it, but I know that a lot of my friends, a lot of people I know cannot. It definitely is not inclusive of sizes at all. I'll go into all of that a little bit more later on, but for now, focusing on company. So for the numbers, for the numeros, the financials, they've been doing really well. I mean, they keep their financials under lock and key. So like, I really dug around for it and I couldn't really find anything except for an estimated annual revenue of around $93 million, which is a lot. But again, financial reports are very limited and they are very secretive about that kind of stuff. Moving on to the second C, customers. You're looking at a customer right here, right? Like their average customer, I'm gonna break it down into demographics and psychographics. So for demographics, it's like 15 to 25 year old people in urban areas like California and New York, or in European countries such as Italy, France, Switzerland, Spain, etc. So a very fun way that as a marketing student, I break down like the customer persona or psychographics, which is encapsulates the target customer's behaviors, needs, wants, attitudes, things like that, is to create a persona. So literally, let's say a typical Brandy customer is like, let's give her the name of Leslie. Fun fact, my mom was about to name me Leslie until her like English teacher suggested the name Jasmine. Kind of a random fun fact, but basically, let's say there's a girl, Leslie. She's 19 years old. She's a college student at UCLA, so Los Angeles, California. Lots of Brandy stores there. She loves doing beach picnics and beach walks with her friends. She loves taking photos and film photos for that laid-back beachy aesthetic on her Instagram. She prefers like a casual but laid-back classic vibe for her style, and she looks for clothes within the affordable range. That is like the customer that Brandy targets. Okay, moving on to the third C, competitors. So there's a lot of competitors that are very similar in terms of the type of customer that they target. So off of the top of my head, Garage Clothing, Forever 21, H&M, Zara, Urban Outfitters, these are all brands that sell clothes to younger audiences. It operates within fast fashion. That is a category that they operate under. Brandy is a fast fashion company. They come out with lots of different styles and have a lot in inventory, and they aren't the most sustainable. But I will say that they are slightly different from like Shein or Zara, because they do sell clothes that are pretty good quality. A lot of Brandy clothes are 100% or almost 100% cotton, or has a wool blend, things like that. They use a little bit better quality than polyester and stuff like that. Now, you might be thinking, okay, that's great and all, but why make this video if it's just a successful clothing brand, right? Well, here is what makes Brandy so weird. It literally makes them so weird, so strange. I was thinking about it too the other day, which is what prompted me to make this video. I was thinking, you know, I always see ads in my email and stuff like that. I see ads for like PacSun and Urban Outfitters. I see sponsorships also a lot on TikTok. I see like Paige Taylor doing Forever 21 sponsorships all the time, or ThredUp or whatever, right? These brands always do a lot of sponsorships, a lot of like influencer ambassadorship, stuff like that.
This video is sponsored by Princess Polly.
I talked about them a million times, and I would not continue to work with them if I didn't absolutely love them so much.
Once again, I want to give a big thanks to Kohl's for sponsoring this video.
They're really trying to like actively promote their brand and get it out there, but I do not see a single advertisement or a single peep from influencers that are paid for brandy. I literally, there's no ads at all. I mean, think about it. Have you guys ever seen a Brandy Melville ad before? Or have you guys ever even seen sale for Brandy Melville items before? Because I haven't. And that is what drove me to make this video, because I was so interested and I was so curious by that. I was like, how is a brand that first of all sells one size in clothing only, one size, second of all, has had such a controversial past with what its owners have said. They're just racist, right? Blatantly racist owners. Third, a brand that does not have any sponsorships, any push within the influencer world. Four, a brand that has no sales or promotions whatsoever. How are they doing so well? Why is literally every single girl at Cornell the owner of at least one brandy item? Like, come on. Brandy is basically ubiquitous now with young people's fashion. And like many things, it all comes down to the brand identity and marketing, because marketing is what creates value for the customer. So as I said, right, Brandy does not have active promotions or anything like that. So how do they market themselves? Well, first of all, they do have one way in which they mainly market, and it is through Instagram. So I'm sure you guys have probably seen Lily Chi on Instagram being like super cute and stuff, posing in her little Brandy outfits. I think she's very pretty. I think she's the epitome of a Brandy girl, and everyone on their Instagram is a brandy girl. So a brandy girl is kind of like that girl next door, right? She's super sweet, very like laid back and chill. She doesn't put too much work in her hair, put on a lot of makeup. She doesn't pose with a professional photographer. She's just chilling, you know? She got out of bed, put on some light makeup, maybe from Glossier, did her hair a little bit, combed it through, threw on her little brandy fit, and went out into the city, you know? With her friends, they're just hanging out in Central Park or whatever, in Soho, walking around, taking photos. That is the vibe of the brandy girl that is all over their website and Instagram. Now, their Instagram pictures and feed matches their brand's aesthetic and the clothing very well. Now, obviously, right, they're wearing the clothes, but I'm talking about the sort of laid back, candid snapshot kind of moments that they capture. And guess what? Who's modeling and who's taking those photos? Let me think. Oh yeah, teenage girls, okay? Their target audience, again, I said, young teenage girls or young women in general, right? Who's the face of a brandy girl? It's insane how smart they are. The people that take photos for the Instagram and pose for the Instagram and their website are all literally high school girls. And people who are working at the brandies are also high school girls. What is super interesting is that I read an article and it said one of the girls who got recruited to work at their store is also on their product research team. So what a product research team does for a clothing brand is they're usually the ones for Zara, let's say, going to the fashion shows in Milan and Paris and New York. They're the ones who are like jotting down, you know, the trend forecasts and what is popular in terms of color, size, cut, things like that, material, and reporting it back to designers so that they can produce items that are up to date. So the product research team at Brandy is made up or at least consulted by teenage girls. She's a 16-year-old girl, and she talked about in the interview how she was asked, you know, do you like these shirts that we're gonna put up on the website? What would you change about them? Would you wear them? Do you like the cut, or should it be more cropped? Should it be less cropped? They literally go out and recruit people who fit the bill of a brandy customer and ask them exactly what the heck they want and do it. To just wrap up the marketing segment, by putting the brandy models in their outfits and just out about in the city doing their thing, right? Sipping their matchas and going to the record stores or whatever, right? The customer is able to envision themselves wearing those clothes, doing those things. It's very translatable into a lifestyle. You're able to visualize yourself actually wearing those things and going to those places. So as brandy employees like to say, one size fits most. Sorry, can we just talk about that? Like, one size fits most? First of all, the average body shape or body size and height of a young woman in the US does not fit their clothing, okay? their clothing fits the minority of people, or at least definitely less than 50% of people. Obviously, high school girls tend to be a bit on the skinnier side because they're still growing and stuff like that, right? And biologically, that's just how it is. But it still is so exclusive. It's not inclusive at all of sizes. Brandy clothing is roughly like a XS to S. Some items like this jacket or like sweatpants and stuff tend to be on the oversized side. So they're more like medium large maybe. Especially the pants are pretty long, at least I've heard. And my friend who's like 5'3", 5'4", she had to roll the waistband of her Brandy sweats like 5 times and it's still pulling at her feet. Basically, Brandy is a brand that is based on exclusivity. The owners had that vision from the get-go. It's exclusive both in ethnicity and body size and I guess the lifestyle that they're portraying. But one factor for their success amidst this controversy is that they're able to sort of balance this exclusivity with their prices being attainable and with the image of the Brandy girl being someone who isn't like, you know, high fashion, high model, like super luxury. That's definitely not the image or aesthetic of the Brandy brand. So they definitely know how to play into their niche very well and sell items that are affordable and pretty good quality. Also, a very important thing is that they do not try to sell to everyone. That is so important. If you try to cater your products or services to everyone, then no one is going to be loyal. There's not going to be a brand sort of image that comes to mind. When I say Brandy Melville, if you know what it is, you have a very clear sort of image in your head already about like what you associate Brandy with. And that in part is due to their successful catering towards their very specific niche audience. Even Apple, who you might think is targeting everyone because a lot of people have iPhones, they're not. Their target market and the target customer are people in their early 20s, 30s to middle age area, that's like that demographic, who are middle to upper class and able to have disposable income that allows them to be invested in the tech world. So they're probably tech savvy or at least interested in being modern or innovative in terms of their technology and personal devices. So to sort of wrap up this video and really drill the final points home on why Brandy is so successful despite all of the weird shit that they do and don't do is the fact that they sell a lifestyle and they sell an image along with clothes that are trendy and casual and cute according to the demands of actual teen audiences. They sell that image so that when, let's say, Leslie, who's 19 at UCLA, right, when she buys Brandy clothes and puts them on, she feels like cute, laid back, casual girl next door, fits in and who has fun, has friends, and is popular. That's the sort of vibe and lifestyle that they sell. They know their brand and they stick with it. Victoria's Secret did a horrendous job with this. I don't know if you guys even know about the tour that they did, which is a film, I think. It did not do well. Like, people mostly did not like it. And Victoria's Secret seems to have forgotten their brand and forgotten their target audience, which kind of sucks for them. Whew. So that is it for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed. I know I really had fun just digging into this because it's just so strange to me at first. Like, how could it be such a profitable brand and do so well and open more stores and stuff if they literally go against every single retail brand ever? So yeah, hopefully you guys learned a thing or two. I definitely did. Will I still buy at Brandy? If I find a piece that I really like, I will. Always question brands and businesses and why they do what they do. And if you guys have any ideas for me to analyze, drop it down below also. Yeah, love you.